I would like to repeat that we are live on YouTube as well. So it's 12. So good afternoon, all the participants. I am Shubham, and on behalf of Webtel Electrosoft Private Limited, I would like to welcome you all to another session of Webtel Vigyan webinar series. Thank you so much for taking out time and joining us here. Webtel has the best range of compliance software and integrated services from GST, e-invoicing, TDS, tax, SBRL to other professional products like Virtual Office WebEdge. We already have a customer base of around 40,000 professionals and big corporates. Before we begin with the webinar, I would like to request all the participants to kindly switch off their videos for a better bandwidth. And kindly post your queries in the chat box, which will be answered at the end of the session. Also, I can see, just in case if you are unable to hear the voice or you have any issue in the audio, you can surely connect our live streaming at our YouTube channel, that is Webtel Electrosoft. So without wasting much of time, I would like to tell about the today's topic, which is indeed very interesting. 20 case studies on place of surprise of services in GST. The same will be taken by CA Tushar Agarwal ji and CA Abhishek ji from Tatvam Advisors. Welcome, sir. Welcome, Tushar ji. Welcome, Abhishek.
Thank you so much, Shubham ji.
Thank you.
It is my pleasure to introduce Mr. Agarwal ji, who has more than 10 years of experience in indirect tax. He has worked with LKS for around 8 years. He was also deployed with GSTN for GST implementation and has worked closely with government officials. He has worked extensively with the Government of India during the designing of GST returns, audit and other formats. Sir's area of expertise is GST advisory, compliance, audit, GST litigation. So welcome to Tushar sir.
Thank you sir, thank you.
Sir, it's again an honor to have you here. Further to this, I would like to introduce Mr. Mittal ji, who specializes in indirect tax and has more than 3 years of experience. He was earlier associate with LKS. So welcome, Mittal ji.
Thank you, sir.
So without wasting much of the time, I would pass on the relay to Tushar sir to the webinar. And I again request all the participants to kindly switch off their videos for better bandwidth. And in case they have any problem with the audio, to kindly connect to our YouTube channel. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, friends. We all know that GST is a destination-based concept, meaning thereby that the state where the goods and services are consumed will get the state component of the GST. How do you determine where in which state the goods and services are consumed? Let me take an example. I am a consultant. There is a client whose head office is in Gurgaon. He gives me the task and assignment of doing some audit of a plant located in Chhattisgarh. So I went to Chhattisgarh with my team, did audit and gave the audit report to the head office located in Gurgaon, based on which head office will take certain decisions. So in which state the services are consumed? Is it Gurgaon, where the head office is located, or is it Chhattisgarh, where I have went and actually performed the services? Some taxpayers may say it is Chhattisgarh because you went there, you performed the services there. Somebody may say, some taxpayers, that it is Gurgaon, that is Haryana, because ultimately the contract was given by Haryana and the Haryana head office told me to undertake this assignment. If you ask states, then Chhattisgarh state will say place of supply consumption is happening in Chhattisgarh. If you ask Haryana, Haryana will say that consumption is happening in Haryana, so tax should flow there. That's why Parliament took the control of place of supply and they said, relax, let not individual taxpayers and state decide where the services and goods are getting consumed. let me decide it. Let me make a provisions determining where the goods and services are consumed. That's why the parliament came out with place of supply provisions under the IGST Act to determine in which state the services and goods are getting consumed, so that that respective state can get the GST component. From a taxpayer's perspective, this is very important, this concept of place of supply, to determine whether I have to charge IGST or CGST, SGST. Mm-hmm. We all know that to determine whether IGST is levyable or CGST, SGST is levyable, there are two important components. First, location of the supplier. Location of the supplier in short means the location where the supplier is located and from where he is making the supply. That is his billing state. The state from where he is making the supply, he has to bill. In short, billing state. Place of supply is the state where the goods and services are getting consumed. That is the consumption state. If these two states are different, IGST is levyable. If these two states are same, CGST and SGST is levyable. Now, let's take an example. So what we will do in our entire session, we will take certain case studies, certain examples. Based on these case studies, we will understand the entire concept of location of supplier as well as place of supply. I am a consultant. My head office is in Maharashtra, Mumbai. And I have a branch office, say, in Gurgaon. A client comes to me and asks me to provide consultancy services. Now, there can be two ways of providing consultancy services. First scenario, it is my head office who will actually enter into the contract with my customer. It is the head office who has necessary human and technical resources and who has the ability to actually execute this contract, who will be actually controlling and supervising the contract. But while executing this contract, my Gurgaon branch will also support my head office. So this is my first scenario. Second scenario, head office is only playing a role in the nature of administrative role. It is the branch who will at ground level actually execute the assignment. It is the branch who will actually control the assignment, deal with my customer, and has sufficient technical and human resources. Now we have discussed two scenarios. Now under each of the scenario, from where should I do billing? What is the location of the supplier? Which state will I say I should do billing? Which is the location of the supplier? For this, let us understand the meaning of location of supplier. The term location of the supplier is defined under the Act. And it says in a very simple term, if a taxpayer has multiple establishments, the way we discussed in our scenario, then the establishment most directly concerned with the provision of output service will be treated as location of supplier. That is the establishment most directly concerned. How do you determine which establishment is more directly concerned with the provision of my output service? For this, we have various provisions laid down under the Indian Act as well as the foreign jurisprudence. If we actually see all the foreign jurisprudence, etc., the sum and circumstance, I will not get much into the judgments, etc. I will be discussing more on the principles concept which have been laid down by these judgments. All those rulings, etc., internationally as well as in India, which is available, which talks about establishment more concerned, mostly directly concerned with the provision of output service, it says that there are various factors which you have to consider. First, which establishment is entering into contract, which establishment is actually controlling and supervising the entire execution of the project, which establishment has actually the human and technical resource to deliver the contract. Given this background, given these factors, you have to find out which is the establishment most directly concerned. Now, in our example, which we discussed, the first scenario, it was the head office, which was actually executing the project at ground level, which was controlling and supervising the project, and which had technical and human resources. So in this scenario one, which we discussed, it will be the head office, which will qualify as location of the supplier. I should raise invoice from the head office. However, my branch is also supporting head office in execution of this project. And under the GST law, we must note that every registration of a legal entity, if I have a office in Mumbai as well as Gurgaon. Both are registered separately. Every such registration is treated as distinct person and supply from one distinct person to another distinct person, even without consideration, is taxable. So in our scenario, one example, vis-a-vis customer, it was my head office, which was most directly connected establishment. And hence, bill should be raised by the head office to the customer because it had the necessary human technical resource and was controlling the assignment. However, the support which branches is providing to a head office, my branch should raise a cross charge invoice on my head office for the support provided by branches to head office. So in fact, there are two transactions. Now in the scenario two, it was my branch who was actually executing the project at ground level. It was my branch who was having the necessary control and human and technical resources. So in example two, my branch will qualify as a location of the supplier and they should raise invoice to my customer. And the head office is merely providing administrative support to the branches. For this administrative support provided by the branches, my head office should raise invoice on branches. Let's take another example. I am a taxpayer. I am located in Delhi. I have a property in the state of Maharashtra and I rent out that property. Which is the location of the supplier? Is it the Delhi where I am located or is it the Maharashtra where the property is located? Can I say that since property is located in Maharashtra, so location of supplier is Maharashtra, I should bill from Maharashtra. Let me go take a registration in Maharashtra and let me bill from Maharashtra. Friends, what we have discussed is that location of the supplier has been defined to mean an establishment most directly concerned with provision of output service. So it talks about establishment. So we need to find out whether in Maharashtra, am I having a establishment by virtue of merely having an immovable property? So what do you mean by establishment? The term establishment is defined under the GST Act and it means an establishment means a place having sufficient degree of permanent and suitable structure with human and technical resources. So there has to be a human and technical resource. For understanding this concept of a fixed establishment, I will just take one very landmark judgment under the European law, which lay down the concept of fixed establishment. And in fact, based on these judgments, the provisions have been borrowed in Indian Act. The judgment in the case of Venterberg Laws. The facts were very simple. In this case, the SSC was operating gaming machines and they were deploying these gaming machines at various places, that is on ferry boats, etc. The issue before the court was the place where this gaming machine is deployed, is that place a fixed establishment? Should I take registration there? Should the tax be go to the place where this fixed establishment, where this machine is located? To which the European Court of Justice held that fixed establishment requires a permanent presence of both human and technical resources. In this case, the machine was located at a particular place. It was operational on its own. There was no human intervention required. Customer could have come, inserted the coin and played the game, etc. And since there was no presence of human, hence it will not qualify as an establishment. Basis this example, basis this judgment, in our case study, what we are discussing, in the state of Maharashtra, where my property is located, it's merely the property which is located. I don't have any human presence there. I'm merely renting out the property which is located in Maharashtra to the customer. So that property per se will not qualify as a fixed establishment because there are no human and technical resources which are present there. So in the absence of such human and technical resources being present in the state of Maharashtra, it will be my daily location where I am located, from where I am entering into the contract, and that will qualify as a location of the supplier. So I need not take registration in Maharashtra. I can pay tax from the state of Delhi itself. Another example, I am a service provider engaged in repair and maintenance services. I am located in Delhi. A client comes to me from Gurgaon and asks me to undertake R&M for his house, repair and maintenance of his house. It is an activity of 4-5 days. I will take the material from Delhi, go to Gurgaon, undertake repair and maintenance and come back. In this example, it is not the Gurgaon state where my establishment is located. I'm merely going there, performing the services and coming back. The location of the supplier is Delhi only, from where I'm providing the services. You don't have an establishment in Gurgaon, so I cannot say that I'm providing services from Gurgaon. Please appreciate that performance of service is different from the concept of location of supplier. The fact that I'm doing repair and maintenance in Gurgaon does not mean that location of the supplier is Gurgaon. The establishment which is undertaking this contract is Delhi establishment. Contrary to this, let us take another example. I am an EPC service provider. I execute turnkey contracts, which runs for 2 to 3 years, 4 years. I am located in Delhi. I got an EPC contract from Maharashtra for construction of a building. It will take almost 3 years, 4 years to execute these projects, etc. I open my site office in Maharashtra, where I will keep my goods, my people will stay, my people will sit. Then the situation will differ, because now in Maharashtra, I have a site office which will qualify as an establishment. Now in Maharashtra, there is a project office, there is a site office, which is a establishment. I am now, that establishment is the establishment which is more directly concerned with the provision of services. So that, in that situation, my answer will change. So we have to be very careful when you're determining the location of the supplier of service. Firstly, you need to determine whether you have an establishment or not. If there is no establishment in another state, then there is no issue. However, if there is an establishment, for example, there is a fixed office, there is a branch office there, there is a site office there, then I have to determine which is the location most directly concerned with. Similar to this, let me take one more example of a banking industry. A customer approaches SBI, Gurgaon branch, for availment of loan. Branch will undertake all initial scrutiny, verification, documentation, etc. And then they will provide these documents to the head office in Mumbai for approval of loan, because the loan exceeds a certain limit. Is it head office providing the services, or is it branch which is providing the services in respect of processing charges which bank will charge for giving of loan? Which is the establishment most directly concerned with? To my mind, it is the branch, because they are actually executing the contract with the customer. They are actually dealing with the customer. They are doing provisioning of loan, verification, etc. Head office is merely providing the approval and doing administrative tasks. So it is my home branch which should raise invoice to my customer, and my head office should provide support to the branch for which they should raise the cross charge invoice. Having discussed the concept of fixed establishment and location of supplier, etc., now let us move and discuss the concept of place of supply and case studies related to place of supply of services. Mm-hmm. Friends, section 12 and 13 are the relevant sections for the purpose of case studies. Section 12 applies where supplier and receiver is in India, and section 13 applies when either the supplier or receiver is outside India. So in respect of domestic transactions where both supplier and receiver are in India, I will refer to section 12 for finding out the place of supply. And in respect where once either the supplier or receiver is outside India, that is in respect of export and import transactions, I will refer to section 13. Section 2 further is divided into two parts. We have specific rules and we have a general rule. We have specific rules for certain kind of services. If I'm not covered under any of the specific rule, I will fall under the general rule. Now, what does the general rule say? General rule says that the place of supply in respect of B2B transactions shall be the location of recipient, and place of supply in respect of B2C transactions, that is, if I'm supplying a service to an unregistered customer, then if address on record is available, it is the location of recipient, else it is the location of the supplier. So in respect of B2C supplies, if my address on record is available, place of supply shall be the location of recipient, else it will be the location of the supplier. Now, what do you mean by address on record? Let's discuss a case study. I am owning a food app, say Zomato or Swiggy. I'm located in Delhi. A customer logins to my app and orders a give me an order on my app. I deliver the food to my customer. When he logs into my app, he even gives his delivery address. So it may so happen that in the morning, he is giving me the address of dairy location. And in the evening, when he is ordering, he's giving me the address of Gurgaon location. Maybe he's at friend's house in the evening, he's ordering from there. So I keep on getting delivery location of the customer based on wherever he is located. In this scenario, can I say the delivery location which the customer is providing to me? Is it the address on record? What do you mean by address on record? The term address on record, to my mind, means a place where the customer resides. So it has to be the residential address of the customer where he is actually residing. In our example, I cannot take this delivery location as the address on record. It is not the place where he is residing. He has given me merely a GPS, the GPS location which I am tracing for delivery, and the delivery location he is giving. I am not sure whether he is residing at delivery location or not. So until and unless I am sure about the delivery location, about the residential address of the customer, I should not take this delivery address as address on record. So in this case, if I don't have a residential address, in this situation, my place of supply shall be the location of supplier only. I will charge CGST, SGST in respect of delivery charges, which I charge. However, if in my app, I make a different policy. I take a residential address as well as I take a delivery address separately. If I take two different address in this situation, it will be my residential address, which I am taking, based on which I will determine my place of supply, because in that case, this residential address will be the address on record. Another example. I am a bank. I issue a credit card. For issuance of credit card, I invite an application form. I give a float application form. Customer comes and fill that application form. In that application form, say he fills his permanent address as Rajasthan, and he fills his current corresponding address where he is doing job, he is working as Gurgaon. So I'm SBI Gurgaon. Customer comes, fill an application form for taking credit card services, give permanent address as Rajasthan, give current address as corresponding address as Gurgaon. Now, what is the location of the recipient? The term location of the recipient is defined to mean the establishment which is most directly concerned with receipt of services, and in the absence of such establishment, the usual place of residence. So in our example, what is the usual place of residence? Which is the residence, will I say, it is the usual place of residence? Is it the permanent address, or is it the current or the corresponding address? Hum kisko the usual place of residence bolenge, Rajasthan address ko ya Gurgaon address ko? To my mind, for analyzing this case study, we please need to appreciate the concept of place of supply. The concept of place of supply is to determine where the consumption is taking place. Consumption konsi states mein ho raha hai. The place of supply provisions which we have made, they have taken immense guidance from European law. जिस तरीके से हमारी कंट्री में एक कंसेप्ट है कि किस स्टेट के अंदर कंजम्पशन हो रहा है सो दैट उस स्टेट के पास पैसा जाए, सिमिलरली वी हैव अ कॉन्सेप्ट इन यूरोप ऑल्सो. देर इज अ कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ यूरोपियन यूनियन वेयर देर आर वेरियस कंट्रीज इन यूरोपियन यूनियन, यूनाइटेड किंगडम, जर्मनी, फ्रांस, ये मल्टीपल कंट्रीज मिलकर यूरोपियन यूनियन बनाती है. वहां पर भी वी फाइंड अ सिमिलर कॉन्सेप्ट प्लेस ऑफ सप्लाई टू डिटरमाइन कि किस कंट्री के अंदर प्लेस ऑफ सप्लाई फॉल कर रहा है, किस कंट्री के अंदर कंजम्पशन हो रहा है, so that country can get the tax. So when we talk about Europe, the purpose is to identify the country which will get the tax. And when we talk about India, the purpose is to find out the state which will get the tax. There is a beautiful OECD guidelines laid down on the principles of determining ki consumption kaun si state mein hota hai. So wahan par unhone detail mein discuss kiya hai. Wahan par bhi similar rules hain. Jis tarike se India mein, wahan par specific rules hain, ek general rule hai. जब वो जनरल रूल डिस्कस करते हैं, व्हेन दे डिस्कस द जनरल रूल, दे से द पर्पस ऑफ जनरल रूल इज टू आइडेंटिफाई द स्टेट और द कंट्री वेयर द पर्सन इज यूजुअली रिजाइडिंग एंड इज यूजिंग द रिसोर्सेज ऑफ दैट कंट्री एंड इज यूजुअली रिजाइडिंग. देयर दे डिस्कस इन डिटेल द कंसेप्ट ऑफ परमानेंट एड्रेस एज वेल एज करंट एड्रेस, एंड दे हेल्ड दैट इट इज द करंट एड्रेस वेयर ही इज एक्चुअली रिजाइडिंग एंड व्हिच एंड फॉर एंड द कंट्री वेयर ही इज एक्चुअली यूजिंग द रिसोर्सेज विल क्वालिफाई एज अ प्लेस ऑफ सप्लाई. In fact, they went and said, if a customer has residential status in multiple countries, then the country where he resides for most of the time will be treated as the place of supply. हमारा भी क्योंकि सिमिलर कॉन्सेप्ट है प्लेस ऑफ सप्लाई का कंजम्पशन ट्रीट करना सो इट इज द गुड़गांव लोकेशन वेयर द कंजम्पशन इज टेकिंग प्लेस बेस्ड ऑन विच आई शुड डिटरमाइन माय प्लेस ऑफ सप्लाई नॉट परमानेंट एड्रेस व्हेन वी कम टू स्पेसिफिक रूल्स अंडर सेक्शन 12 वी हैव स्पेसिफिक रूल्स फॉर सर्विसेज इन रिलेशन टू इमूवेबल प्रॉपर्टी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ऑफ इवेंट ट्रांसपोर्टेशन ऑफ गुड्स टेलीकम्युनिकेशन ट्रेनिंग सर्विस पैसेंजर सो एंड सो फोर्थ हियर प्लीज नोट दैट In some of the rules, you will find that there is a distinction between B2B and B2C. B2B mein most of the place, it is the location of the recipient which is treated as place of supply. The reason is simple that in case of B2B supply, in case of supply to a registered customer, I want to facilitate the transfer of credit to my customer. Hence, I have put place of supply as location of recipient. B2C mein accordingly, we have different place of supply depending upon the rules. But there are two, three rules where you don't have a distinction between B2B and B2C. And that's why the credit chain is getting broken. And one of the most important rule is services directly in relation to immovable property. This rule says that the place of supply of services directly in relation to immovable property, including construction, etc., and including accommodation services provided by hotel shall be the place where property is located. That's why if I'm in Delhi, I go to a Chennai hotel. Chennai hotel will charge me CGST, SGST because location of supplier is Chennai, place of supply also is Chennai, and I will not get the credit. Not only this, this rule is also a subject matter of interpretation. Let me just discuss. I am a taxpayer engaged in supply of security services. Of an immovable property. I have placed my guards at the immovable property which is located in Delhi and my recipient is located outside Delhi, say Kolkata. Now, location of the supplier is Delhi, fine. What is the place of supply of my security services? Is it Delhi where the immovable property is located or is it Kolkata where my recipient is located? The rule says place of supply of services directly in relation to an immovable property. Can I say security services is directly in relation to immovable property, hence place of supply is immovable property, or will I say that it has no link with immovable property, it's a separate service, hence I will fall under the general rule and place of supply shall be recipient. Food for thought. Second, legal services. I am providing legal services and I can provide two kinds of legal services. I am a lawyer located in Delhi. Property is also located in Delhi and my recipient is in, say, Kolkata. I provide first kind of services which I provide is execution of conveyance deed for transfer of property. Say my client is transferring the property which is located in Delhi. For transferring that property, I'm making and executing the conveyance deed, etc. So services which I provide, is it directly in relation to immovable property which is located in Delhi or it will fall under general rule and place of supply will be location of recipient, which is Kolkata. Third, legal services in respect of computation of capital gain. यही property जो मैं transfer कर रहा हूँ उसपे जो capital gain compute करना है, उसके लिए मैं legal services provide कर रहा हूँ। क्या उस situation में मेरा legal services का place of supply? Can I say it is a service in relation to immovable property, or it will fall under general rule? How do you determine which services will fall under services in relation to immovable property? For which it is relevant to refer to various jurisprudence available in India as well as foreign laws. I will not get into the judgments. I will just discuss the principles which they have laid down. They simply say that how do we determine whether a service is in relation to immovable property? Three, four major criteria. First, if you are changing the physical characteristics of the property, that is, you go to that property, you do a construction work, you do architect work, you physically change that property. That is services in relation to immovable property, which will have a close nexus with the immovable property. Second example which they give, and the second criteria which they lay down is whether services is protecting your immovable property, whether that service which you are providing, it results in protection of immovable property. So if that service results in protection of immovable property, then that service is closely linked with immovable property. Now, in our example, security services, is it protecting immovable property? Yes, sir, it is definitely protecting immovable property. Since it is for protection of immovable property, and protection of immovable property is one of the criteria for qualifying as services in relation to immovable property. So to my mind, supplier of security services, the place of supply shall be the property where it is located. Now the third criteria, whether that property results in change in ownership of the property, whether the services which I am providing, it has effect on the ownership of the property. When I come to my example, legal services for computation of capital gain on transfer of immovable property, is it affecting my ownership of the immovable property? No, it is not affecting. I am merely computing the capital gain. So it is not a service to my mind in relation to immovable property. However, the services of execution of conveyance deed, is it affecting the ownership of my property? Yes, it is affecting the ownership of my property. Hence, to my mind, legal services in execution of conveyance deed as a service in relation to immovable property and place of supply shall be where my immovable property is located. Another common issue being faced by lots of warehouse service providers. You may have all of a sudden, because of sudden lockdown, etc., all the goods which was in the course of transportation, all the taxpayers had to actually store those goods at warehouses. Now I am a taxpayer located in Gurgaon. I was sending my goods to my customer in Bangalore, but because of lockdown, it has to be stored in some warehouse in Maharashtra. Now that Maharashtra warehouse service provider is providing me the services of storing my goods and charging me certain amount, I will pay consideration to him. Now, what will be the place of supply of services which he will charge? If I say the services of warehousing is a service in relation to immovable property, then place of supply shall be Maharashtra. He will charge CGST, SGST. I will not get credit in Delhi. However, if this services is not in relation to immovable property, he will charge me IGST under general rule and I will get the credit. So can I say this service of storing and warehousing is a service in relation to immovable property? To my mind, in case of warehousing services, you don't have a right to enter to the premises of the service provider. He can store his goods anywhere in the warehouse. He is providing the service of merely storing the goods and not giving the access of warehouse. So to my mind, that close link between the service and immovable property is not established, and it's not a service in relation to immovable property. However, had there been a case where he demarcates a separate area in the warehouse, and he gives me exclusive right to that warehouse, that area, and he does not have liberty to store goods of any other person in that area, in such a situation, place of supply will be that particular area. That is where the immovable property is located. So actual facts will make a big difference. So till now, what we have discussed, concept of place of supply and concept of location of supplier, both are independent concepts. Practically, in our experience, there are situations where place of supply actually plays a role in determining location of supplier also. I will just give you an example. I am located in Gurgaon. I got a contract for construction of optical fiber line across India. So I will lay down this fiber line, underground fiber lines across India. So wherever, in whichever states I am laying down my optical fiber line, my place of supply shall be the states where my optical fiber laid down is laid down, because optical fiber line results into immovable property, and services in relation to immovable property, place of supply is where immovable property is located. So in our example, place of supply shall be Gurgaon, shall be Maharashtra, Gujarat, etc., wherever my optical fiber are laid down. What is the location of the supplier? When we talk to the taxpayer, we say, sir, in each of the states you might open your construction site office, etc. So each of the states should be treated as location of the supplier. Each of the state you should take registration and do billing, etc. Then he argued, no, I will treat location of the supplier as Gurgaon only. I'm executing the project from Gurgaon. Project have been awarded to Gurgaon location. Entire control is from Gurgaon. If optical fiber is laid down in Maharashtra, I will charge IGST. Then we say, sir, will you appoint subcontractor? He says, yes. He will appoint a local subcontractor. When he appoints a local subcontractor in Maharashtra, that local subcontractor will also charge CGST, SGST. because location of supplier of local contractor is Maharashtra, place of supply is also Maharashtra, being services in relation to immovable property. And the CGST SGST which my local contractor will charge, I will not get credit in Gurgaon. Since I will not get credit in Gurgaon, then my taxpayer, my client will rethink. He says, okay, in order to avoid compliance cost, I cannot let my credit go down. Then he will agree and then he will take, okay, let my location of supplier be my respective state. So I will take registration in that state, will charge CGST, SGST in that state and will take credit of the subcontractor and let my head office provide support services to my subcontractor. So that's the practical scenario where place of supplier provisions actually plays an important role in determining location of supplier. Now, with this background, now I will ask my colleague Abhishek to discuss certain case studies related to other provisions. And then in the end, we will discuss the concept of intermediaries and case studies related to that. Over to you, Abhishek.
Thank you, sir. Sir, can you please stop sharing your screen? So, good afternoon all. Having discussed the place of supplier services in relation to immovable property, let us now have a look at other place of supply provisions contained in section 12, that is where my supplier as well as recipient is located in India. So what I will do is I'll read the provision first and then discuss the case study so that it can be analyzed carefully, right? So let us first discuss about place of supply in respect of admission or organization of an event. As per subsection 6 of section 12, place of supply of services for admission to an event or any services ancillary to that event shall be the place where event is held, irrespective of whether the services are provided to a registered person or an unregistered person. Here, what admission means is it is granting the right of entry to the event. As far as organization of an event is concerned, its place of supply shall be the location of recipient where it is provided to a registered person. However, where services are provided to an unregistered person and the event is held in India, it is the POS shall be the place where event is held. In case the event is held outside India, the POS shall be location of recipient as both my supplier and my recipient are located in India only. So POS shall be in India only. Here organization means services similar to that of event managers. Now, let us take a practical example related to said provision. As you all are aware, British Council holds IELTS exam, which are the results of which are used by foreign universities. Now, what British Council do is it outsources the activity of conduct of examination to third party, say X. Now, what X does is that it is required to arrange the venue, look after the seating arrangement, supply the test material and supervise the students, etc. However, it is not at all involved in evaluation of result or operating of the exam. As it can be seen that the section covers services by way of organization of an event. So, what do you think? Can conducting of examination be said to be an event? Can we say that X is providing services of organizing educational event to British Council? So I would like to bring to your notice that the word event has nowhere been defined under GST Act. And after going through various dictionary meaning, it can be understood that event means anything that occurs, manifesting changes, lasting for a short time, etc. Therefore, event is basically a broad term since it includes all sorts of activities that take place. But the usage of expression admission or organization limits the scope of the word event. According to me, we can say that this whole activity of making premises suitable for conduct of examination and ensuring that the examination goes on smoothly shall be construed as organization. Further, a number of judgment has held that the event does not only include artistic event or culturistic event. So, in light of the same, according to me, conducting of examination shall be covered under section 12.7 and its place of supply shall be the location of recipient of services, where the same is provided to a registered person. the Haryana Advanced Ruling Authority classified the service in case of BC examination and English Services Private Limited under Education Support Services. However, no comment was made regarding the POS of this service. So, in my opinion, classification of the said service under Education Support shall not have any impact on its POS. So, what I want to say here is basically, agar koi bhi पार्टी कोई इवेंट ऑर्गेनाइज कोई एग्जाम ऑर्गेनाइज कराती है कंडक्ट कराती है लेकिन उससे उसके रिजल्ट से इट इज नॉट कंसर्न्ड तो उसको हम कह सकते हैं कि इट इज एन एजुकेशनल इवेंट और उसका प्लेस ऑफ सप्लाई शैल बी गवर्न्ड बाय सेक्शन 12(7). नाउ लेट अस डिस्कस अ केस स्टडी ऑन इंटरप्ले बिटवीन आईटीसी एंड इवेंट मैनेजमेंट सर्विसेज. सपोज आई एम ऑर्गेनाइजिंग अ सेल्स प्रमोशन इवेंट फॉर विच आई प्रोक्योर अ वैरायटी ऑफ सर्विसेज सच एज accommodation services, food and beverage catering services, apart from event manager services. I am not registered in the state in which the sales promotional event is being held. As you all are aware, I will not be able to take credit of the CGST and SGST charged by the hotels. Further, the credit of food and beverage as well as the catering is specifically barred under section 17(5). So what we shall do is now, let us change the structure of the transaction so that blockage of ITC on my end is minimum. What I'll do is, I will hire a local event manager who shall book hotels as well as caterers for company for me along with the provision of event management services. Will now ITC be available to me, or can it be said that event managers cannot provide accommodation services, therefore ITC shall not be available? Let us look at the POS provision first. It says that POS in case of services of organization of event shall be the location of recipient where it is provided to a registered person. That is, the event manager shall be required to charge IGST on the services provided by it. This value of accommodation and food and beverage and catering shall be included in the value of event management services provided by him. So this section basically does not limit the scope of organization, and a lot of companies give the entire contract of event management to another company so that it does not have to go through the headache of booking an event or hotels or caterers, etc. Therefore, in this case, what I've done is I've structured the transaction in such a way that credit of accommodation and outdoor catering in respect of my sales promotional event is made available to me. In case the department contend that the event managers cannot provide accommodation services and ITC shall not be available, it is a good case to argue, and this argument of department shall not sustain in court. So, कहीं पे भी अगर मैं किसी state में event कराता हूँ, जहाँ पे मैं registered नहीं हूँ, उस case में क्या करना चाहिए? मेरे को एक local event manager hire करना चाहिए, जो ही मेरे लिए accommodation book करेगा और caterers book करेगा, जिससे उसका credit मेरे को available हो जाए. Let us discuss one more case study on organization or admission of an event. As you can see, the section covers place of supply of services ancillary to the event. Now, the question arises as to what services will be considered ancillary to event. Suppose I have hired a ticket agency company who shall book tickets for the event on behalf of me. Further, I am procuring the services of outdoor caterer for my event. Shall these services be considered ancillary to the event? I would like to bring to your notice that majority of our place of supply provisions have been borrowed from the UK VAT. And for analyzing the same in detail, a detailed study of UK VAT is required. In case of Jagan Dadda, the European Court of Justice held that the term ancillary has to be understood from the objective point of view. Where the activities are prerequisites for performance, there it can be regarded as ancillary. For example, sound engineering services. This concept of prerequisite has also been identified by education guide issued by the department in service tax regime. Therefore, in my opinion, services of ticket agent shall get covered under services ancillary to event. For catering services, since there is a separate place of supply provision exists, it shall get covered there, as per which place of supply shall be the location where services are performed. तो बेसिकली एंसिलरी का हम मतलब क्या बनाएंगे? एंसिलरी क्या होगा? जो भी मेरे को परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ इवेंट के लिए प्री रिक्विजिट होगा, जो भी रिक्वायर्ड होगा इवेंट परफॉर्म करने के लिए, उनको हम क्लासिफाई कर सकते हैं एज सर्विसेज एंसिलरी टू द इवेंट. तो इन आर केस द सर्विसेज ऑफ टिकट बुकिंग एजेंट शैल बी कंसीडर्ड एंसिलरी, एंड फॉर केटरिंग, क्योंकि स्पेसिफिक provision exist karta hai and it is a well settled provision that specific provision prevail over general, to fir catering ke liye wo wala provision applicable ho jayega. So having discussed the services in relation to event in detail, let us now discuss a case study related to transportation services. As per section 12(8), the place of supply of services by way of transportation of goods, including by mail or courier to a registered person, shall be the location of such person. A person other than a registered person shall be the location at which such goods are handed over for transportation. Notification 1/2019 brought into effect the amendment in IGST Act. A proviso to said subsection was added as per which where transportation of goods is to place outside India, POS shall be the destination of goods. Now, suppose I am sending some documents outside India through courier. What shall be the place of supply of such courier services? Prima facie, one may say that the said services of courier agency shall get covered under the proviso added through the notification. But there is a catch here. Let us go through the provisions again. Section 12(8) talks about place of supply of services by way of transportation of goods, including through mail or courier. However, proviso only talks about transportation of goods. It is pertinent to note that transportation through mail or courier is not covered in this proviso. It states that transportation of goods and nowhere mentions the words including mail or courier. Even section 13 specifically mentions these words. Therefore, where I have transported anything through mail or courier outside India, its POS shall be governed by the normal section and not by the proviso. So, jaisa ki aap dekh sakte hain, kyunki hamare section mein to specifically words covered hai including by mail or courier, but notification only talks about transportation of goods. तो कुछ भी हम ट्रांसपोर्ट करते हैं थ्रू कोरियर, इट शैल गेट कवर्ड अंडर नॉर्मल प्रोविजन ओनली. द नेक्स्ट इशू इज रिगार्डिंग सप्लाई ऑफ फूड ऑन बोर्ड. लेट अस हैव अ लुक एट द प्रोविजन फर्स्ट. इट स्टेट्स दैट प्लेस ऑफ सप्लाई ऑफ सर्विसेज ऑन बोर्ड अ कन्वेयंस शैल बी द लोकेशन ऑफ फर्स्ट शेड्यूल्ड पॉइंट ऑफ डिपार्चर ऑफ दैट कन्वेयंस फॉर जर्नी. लेट अस टेक अ केस स्टडी ऑन इट. सपोज the train journey starts from Jammu. I have boarded the train from Delhi and ordered food for myself. Now there are two options available. I can book the food while booking my train journey with IRCTC, or I can order food from some restaurant, say Domino's. What do you think? Shall both the suppliers, that is IRCTC and Domino's, be covered under this provision? Let us take a look at the provision again. As you can see, it covers supply of services on board or conveyance, that is during the journey, irrespective of whether train has stopped at any station or not. Therefore, in my opinion, where food is supplied by IRCTC on train or by IndiGo on airlines, place of supply of the same shall be the first scheduled point of departure of that journey, that is in my case it shall be Jammu. As far as food delivery from Domino's is concerned, it cannot be said that this food is supplied in train. It's like normal home delivery where the address of delivery is train station. Therefore, the food supplied by Domino's shall not be covered under this section. So basically what the crux is, ki jiske bhi through hum train journey ya fir apni airlines ki journey book karate, be it SpiceJet, be it IndiGo, IRCTC, वो वाला वो अगर कुछ सर्विसेज हमें प्रोवाइड करती है तो वो तो हमारे कवर हो जाएंगे इस वाले सेक्शन में. बट अगर हम किसी रेस्टोरेंट से ऑर्डर करते हैं जो हमारे ट्रेन में हमें आके फूड डिलीवर कर जाते हैं, वो वाली सर्विसेज इधर कवर नहीं है. सो एज द टाइम इज लिमिटेड, वी कैन नॉट कवर केस स्टडी फॉर एवरी प्रोविजन. देयरफॉर वी हैव कवर्ड मेजर इश्यूज एग्जिस्टिंग इन इंडस्ट्री इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ सेक्शन 12. लेट अस नाउ have a look at major issues pertaining to section 13. Before discussing the same, it is important to see why this section was required. Export and import of service have been specifically defined in section 2 of IGST Act. As you can see that for export, it is important that POS shall lie outside India, whereas for import, it shall be in India. exported zero rate supply in under GST. Therefore, it is important to determine what constitutes an export. And since RCM is applicable on import, it also becomes an important concept. So for determining the same, a separate section was needed so that services which are consumed in India is not considered as export if normal provisions are applicable. Having said that, let us now have a look at the provision of section 13, that is where either the supplier or the recipient is located outside India. Section 13.3a states that the place of supply of services supplied in respect of goods which are required to be made physically available to the supplier of services in order to provide the services shall be the location where services are performed. Now, let us discuss a case study. Suppose I have manufactured the goods and gets the goods tested by outside agency. For getting the goods tested, it is mandatory for me to deliver these goods to the supplier, without which he won't be able to perform his services, right? So, shall it get covered in the provision discussed that services where goods are required to be sent to the supplier? I guess this is a clear-cut case and there is no dispute that such services shall get covered here and there. Let us now take another example. Suppose I have wanted to get my goods certified for its quality and send a sample of goods to outside agency for the certification of goods. The agency shall carry out inspection and shall provide a certification report to me. Shall it get covered under this provision? So, to check that, basically we have to understand the meaning of the term in respect of goods here. As you can see, this provision specifically covers services supplied in respect of goods. The meaning of the term in respect of goods becomes really important. So I would like to bring to your notice that this has been a matter of high dispute under service tax as well. So after going through the dictionary meaning, it can be understood that this expression conveys some connection or relation in between the subject matters, which in our case is the goods and the services. Under this section, this phrase has been used to depict a connection between the service and the goods. Even the Supreme Court had interpreted the meaning of this term in various judgments, for example, Swastik Tobacco Factory, and held that in respect of means on the goods. Even the UK House of Lord in Inland Revenue Commissioners versus Coats and Company observed that the phrase denoted some kind of nexus between the property and the duty. Apart from the judgments, even the education guide has also discussed the term in detail. As per the guide, this provision does not cover services where supply of goods by the receiver is not material to the rendering of the service. The service must relate to the goods, you know. If the goods related service is only an incidental part of comprehensive service, then it shall not be covered here. So, in my opinion, since this activity of certification is not an activity which is required to be undertaken for making a supply, such inspection services shall not be covered in this section. Even education guide held the same for marketing research where goods were provided to supplier for carrying out the research. So, in my opinion, the instant case shall be governed by general rule where place of supply shall be the location of recipient where address on record exists. My next case study relates to sponsorship services. It's an interesting one. In order to discuss the same, let us first look at section 12. It covers services in relation to organization of event, services ancillary to an event, and services by way of assigning sponsorship rights to an event. Its counterpart in section 13 does not explicitly talks about the services of assigning of sponsorship rights. Now, suppose I am holding an event in Delhi for which a foreign party has agreed to sponsor me. What shall be the place of supply of sponsorship services? Here, two opinions are possible. One may say that since sponsorship services have been explicitly provided in section 12, but not in section 13, therefore, where sponsorship is provided by a foreign company, it shall be governed by general rule and POS shall be the location of sponsor. Other argument which is possible that the sponsorship services are ancillary to the event. To see which argument is more sustainable, let us first have a look what sponsorship means in common parlance. So sponsorship includes naming an event after the sponsor, displaying the sponsor title or trading name, giving the sponsor exclusive rights, prizes, trophies, etc. So basically, sponsorship rights can vary from company to company, but the services are an essential part of organizing an event, as it provides organizers with required funds for carrying out the event. As discussed earlier, as per various foreign jurisprudence, services ancillary to the event means those services without which event cannot be performed. The ECJ, in the case of Sugar and Spice, held that if the ancillary services did not take place, then the performance of event is itself not possible. Since sponsors are one of the main requisite for performing an event, as without funds, there cannot be an event, sponsorship services shall be considered to be services ancillary to the event, and POS shall be the place where event is performed. So, in my opinion, जहाँ पे भी हम फॉरेन पार्टी से कोई स्पॉन्सरशिप लेते हैं तो वो वाला केस हमारा इसी वाले प्रोविजन में कवर्ड हो जाना चाहिए, चाहे एक्सप्लिसिटली प्रोवाइड नहीं किया गया है सेक्शन 12 के अंदर. Why? Because as per foreign jurisprudence, it can be said to be services ancillary to the event. Now, my next case study relates to courier services. Suppose I wanted to transport some goods outside India, for which I have appointed a foreign courier agency. In which clause shall the services of courier agency fall? Here, I would like to bring to your notice that Section 13(8) specifically states that it shall be applicable on transportation of goods other than by way of mail or courier. Therefore, services of courier agency is not covered under that section. Now, can it be said that the courier services shall get covered under Section 13(3)(a), that is services provided in respect of goods? The education guide covered courier services under the said provision. However, it may be noted that for a service to be covered under this provision, some performance on the goods is necessary. In case of courier services, nothing is being done on the goods. Courier service is basically a kind of service involving transportation or time-sensitive goods or documents. So therefore, such kind of services cannot be grouped along with performance-related services like dry cleaning, etc., and cannot be covered under Section 13(3)(a). Section 13(8) provides that place of supply of services supplied by a banking company or a financial institution or NBFC to account holders shall be the location of supplier of services. Suppose I have taken an external commercial borrowing from a bank. Foreign bank. Shall it get covered under this provision? What is the meaning of account holder? Here, it is to be noted that the account has been defined under GST Act, and as per the definition, account means an account bearing interest to the depositor and includes a non-resident external account and a non-resident ordinary account. I would like to bring to your notice that it only covers account with deposit which depositor have with the bank. In my opinion, since I'm not a depositor but a borrower, and also since some of the ECBs does not bear interest, the charges in respect of such ECB shall not be covered under this clause, and general provision shall be applicable on it. तो हमें अकाउंट होल्डर की डेफिनेशन पे खासकर से ध्यान देना पड़ेगा इस सेक्शन में, क्योंकि ये वाला सेक्शन सिर्फ उन्हीं पे अप्लाई होता है जहां पे भी बैंकिंग कंपनी सर्विसेज प्रोवाइड करती है अकाउंट होल्डर्स को. नाउ My next case study relates to intermediary services. According to me, this is the most disputable area as far as place of supply provisions are concerned. I would like Tushar sir to discuss this concept and carry on with the slides incorporated after that. Sir, over to you. I have stopped sharing my screen.
Thank you, Abhishek. I'm just sharing my screen. Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
So intermediary is a very important concept which we all must know. Let's take an example. I am a service provider located in India. There is a customer, say in USA, and my role is to find out the customer's for the party in USA. My customer in USA is engaged in selling. My client in USA is engaged in selling his products. And I'm finding out the customers in India for my client in USA. The activity which I undertake and the customer which I find out, I get a certain commission from my client in USA for every customer which I find out. I found a customer, I got 5% commission. So even if I'm earning foreign exchange, even if I'm earning foreign exchange, still it will not qualify as export of service because of the concept of intermediary. The place of supply rule says that the place of supply of intermediary shall be the location of the supplier of service. An intermediary has been defined as a broker, agent, or a middleman who arranges or facilitates supply of goods and services between two parties. So in our example, I am an agent. I am a person who is facilitating supply of goods and services between two parties. That is the client in USA and his customer in India. So even if I earn foreign exchange, still my place of supply is in India. I have to pay tax. Please note that only and only if I am engaged in arranging and facilitating as a middleman between two parties, the supply of goods and service, then only I will be covered under intermediary. Let's take an example. I am engaged in providing outsource activities. Outsource activities, for example, there is a bank who is providing loan to the end customer. For providing that loan to the end customer, there is certain verification required at ground level. So bank has outsourced me this verification work to me. I will undertake that verification and scrutiny work. So the activity which I am providing, it does not mean that I am facilitating the supply between bank and end customer. The word facilitate here has to be read in the context of arrange, and the intent is that I am bringing two parties together for supply of goods. I am acting as their agent, as a middleman. If I am doing a general support service to one of the parties, general business support services, that should not fall under this particular provision. Let's take one case study on this intermediary. I am a person engaged in facilitating the students to get admission in foreign universities. So, बहुत foreign universities होती हैं, उनके India में consultants होते हैं, वो students को guide करते हैं, train करते हैं और facilitate करते हैं बाहर admission लेने का. और पर एडमिशन मुझे पैसे मिलते हैं एज अ कंसल्टेंट. जो जो मुझे पैसे मिल रहे हैं, द कंसिडरेशन विच आई एम गेटिंग फॉर फैसिलिटेटिंग द सप्लाई बिटवीन द फॉरेन यूनिवर्सिटी एंड द एंड स्टूडेंट, एम आई एक्टिंग एज अ इंटरमीडियरी? इट ऑल डिपेंड्स अपॉन द टर्म्स ऑफ द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. सो देयर कैन बी टू केसेस. फर्स्ट केस वेयर माय रोल इज टू एक्चुअली promote the organization, promote the foreign university in India. मेरा रोल जनरली फॉरेन यूनिवर्सिटी को इंडिया में प्रमोट करने का है, स्टूडेंट्स को जनरल कंसल्टेंसी प्रोवाइड करने का है. और जो मुझे पैसे मिलते हैं वो पैसे मुझे कॉस्ट प्लस मार्कअप के बेसिस पे मिलते हैं, मेरी फिक्स कंसिडरेशन है. उस केस में आई कैनॉट से दैट आई एम अरेंजिंग एंड फैसिलिटेटिंग द सप्लाई बिटवीन फॉरेन यूनिवर्सिटी, सप्लाई ऑफ एजुकेशन सर्विसेज बिटवीन फॉरेन यूनिवर्सिटी एंड द स्टूडेंट्स. मुझे कुछ लीड आती है, मैं अपने फॉरेन पार्टी यूनिवर्सिटी को दे देता हूँ, बट माई मेन रोल इज ब्रांडिंग एंड कंसल्टेशन. हाउएवर अगर मेरा कॉन्ट्रैक्ट इस तरीके से ड्राफ्टेड है, माई कॉन्ट्रैक्ट इज ड्राफ्टेड इन अ मैनर दैट माई रोल इज टू एक्चुअली रिक्रूट द स्टूडेंट्स फॉर फॉरेन यूनिवर्सिटी. मेरा रोल स्पेसिफिक दे रखा है कि मुझे स्टूडेंट्स इंडिया में घूमने हैं और रिक्रूट करवाना है फॉरेन यूनिवर्सिटी को, और पर रिक्रूटमेंट मुझे चार्जेस मिलेंगे. देन माई मेन रोल इज एक्चुअली इन रिलेशन टू arranging and facilitating. So this concept of intermediary is very, very important. We have to bear in mind that only in case I'm acting as a middleman, then I will be covered under this. If I'm doing general outsourced activity, general business support, etc. activities, these should not get covered under this. There are various rulings about this. I'm not getting into much of the rulings. But one very interesting case study I would like to discuss, which is one of the hot topic today, the issues faced by investment banker. Ek investment banker ka role kya hota hai? Capital find out, raise karwana companies ke behalf ke liye. Now, I am a company I want to raise capital, I want to issue equity, और मुझे अपनी कंपनी के लिए एक इन्वेस्टर ढूंढना, I want to find out an investor for my company. I go to an investment banker and tell my investment banker, please find a suitable investor for my company. I will issue equity shares to the investor in lieu of the consideration. What investment bankers do? Investment banker will make feasibility report. He will find out investor. He will help in negotiation, etc. And then he will get the deal closed. But by virtue of which I will make issue equity share to the investor and he will provide me the consideration. So the activity undertaken by investor banker, investment banker जो एक investment किसी company में facilitate कर रहा है, equity shares भी किसी company के बिकवा रहा है, और एक investor को on board ला रहा है, क्या उसकी जो services है, is it intermediary? If we see the definition of intermediary, it means a broker, agent or any other person by whatever name called who arranges or facilitates the supply of goods and services or both. Or securities, very important to note, securities is also included in the definition of intermediary. So, agar main do parties ke beech mein supply of securities facilitate kar raha hoon, to kya main iske andar cover ho jaunga? So, in our example, jo hamara investment banker hai, he is facilitating the supply of equity share, sale of equity share from the company to the investor. An investor is putting money on the company, or my role as an investment banker is to facilitate this entire transaction. So, will I get covered under intermediary? Just a food for thought. To my mind, the definition of intermediary is very wide. And if I draft my investment banking contract with the investor in such a manner, with the company in such a manner, that my role or my consideration is dependent actually upon actual investment by the investor. And उसमें जो draft इस तरह clauses इस तरीके से अगर हमारे worded हैं कि I am actually facilitating the supply of shares from normal company to the investor, I may fall under this. Just food for thought for discussing this. So having discussed various case studies, now in the end of our presentation, we will just discuss 2-3 major concepts related to place of supply. First, the government is of the view कि as a recipient, I cannot take input tax credit of that goods and services where place of supply does not fall in the recipient state. I will just give an example. I am a transporter located in Delhi. My client is located in Gujarat. He gives me the contract for transportation of goods outside India. So location of supplier kya hai? Delhi. Main Delhi mein located hu. Mera customer Gujarat mein located hai. He gives me the contract for transportation of goods outside India from his premises in Gujarat to outside India. इस सिचुएशन में हम दोनों इंडिया में लोकेटेड है तो रेलेवेंट रूल कौन सा लगेगा? सेक्शन 12. एंड एज पर सेक्शन 12, प्लेस ऑफ सप्लाई और ट्रांसपोर्टेशन ऑफ गुड्स वेयर डेस्टिनेशन ऑफ गुड्स इज आउटसाइड इंडिया शैल बी द प्लेस वेयर द गुड्स आर डेस्टिनेड. तो हमारे एग्जांपल हम सेक्शन 12 में कवर्ड है क्योंकि लोकेशन ऑफ रिसिपिएंट एंड लोकेशन ऑफ सप्लायर दोनों इंडिया में है और गुड्स बाहर जा रहे हैं. तो इन आर एग्जाम्पल बाय वर्च्यू ऑफ सेक्शन 12(8) लोकेशन ऑफ सर्विस place of supply shall be the destination of goods. So in this, I will raise invoice IG Gujarat party pe, but usme kya likhunga? Other territory, kyunki goods outside India ja rahe hain. I will write other territory, IGST, and place of supply as other territory. So whether my recipient, who's in Gujarat, can he take credit on this invoice? My recipient is located in Gujarat. ITC rules and the provisions under GST law that to avail credit, the place of supply should be in the recipient state. In this, however, government is of the view, so government ki understanding hai, until and unless place of supply is in the recipient state, you will not get the credit. Even if you recall and see GSTR 9, in GSTR 9 table number 8A, only those invoices are auto populated where POC lies in the state of recipient. Jabki aap GSTR 2A download karte ho to usme sare invoices aate hain. Jab aap GSTR 9 dekhte ho to 8A mein jo auto populated invoices aate hain usme government wo invoices include nahi karti hai jiska place of supply recipient state ka nahi hai. So this is an anomaly. To my mind, This restriction imposed under the GST portal is nowhere coming from the law. Second important concept which we have to keep in mind is, before going into place of supply provisions, it is very necessary to determine the nature of the transaction and do the classification. सबसे पहले मुझे classification करना है, फिर place of supply में जाना है. If I am providing bundle of activities, then I have to see which activity I am providing. For example, I am providing accommodation services wherein I am giving complimentary breakfast. Then this is a service wherein accommodation is principal, restaurant breakfast is incidental. So my principal supply is of accommodation service. So जो मेरा place of supply rule लगेगा वो accommodation service का लगेगा. So before getting into place of supply, very very important to determine the classification of services, which is very important. Third issue. If I have a problem in determining place of supply, that what is the place of supply of a particular transaction, can I opt for an advance ruling? Can I go to the advance ruling for determination of place of supply? On this topic, various advance ruling authority did not entertain the application of place of supply, stating that they don't have jurisdiction to decide the place of supply. In my view, this is an incorrect proposition, and in fact, recently the Kerala High Court, in the case of Southern Land Mortgage, have specifically held that place of supply is definitely covered under the heading determination of liability to pay tax, and hence a taxpayer can go and file advance ruling. So you can file advance rulings even in case of place of supply. So with this, we will end our presentation. So today what we discussed was a general concept of location of supplier. Then we discussed place of supply. In location of supplier, we discussed that the establishment which is more directly concerned with provision of service is the location of supplier. Then we discussed the concept of fixed establishment, that the establishment which has human and technical resources will be treated as the establishment most directly concerned. That then we discussed place of supply provisions. In place of supply provisions, we discussed Section 12 and Section 13. Section 12 is applicable where supplier and receiver both are located in India. You have specific rules and general rules. We discussed few case studies related to general rule as well as specific rules. Then we discussed Section 13. Section 13 relates to place of supply when either the party, either the supplier or recipient, is outside India. There we discussed certain case studies, and in the end we discussed that three major concepts. There is no restriction under the law कि आपको credit उसी invoice का मिलेगा जिसका place of supply recipient state में है, but government has imposed this condition. Second, we discussed that it is very important to determine the classification of services. And third, we discussed that you can even opt for advance ruling. With this, now we will take certain questions and answers. I am an importer. One of the question is, I am an importer and I am paying commission to an outside agent. I am making payment to a foreign agent. Am I required to pay reverse charge? Sir, reverse charge is applicable if three conditions are satisfied. Service provider should be located outside India. In this case, yes, your service provider is located outside India. Commission agent is located outside India. The recipient of services should be located in India. Second condition. In this case, yes, you are an importer. You are located in India. Third condition is place of supply should be in India. Now for determining the place of supply of commission services, commission agent services, we must refer to Section 13. And in Section 13, we discuss that the commission agents are specifically covered under the concept of intermediary. And place of supply of intermediary is where intermediary is located. So in your example, commission agent being intermediary, he is located outside India. So place of supply shall be outside India. Hence, any commission paid to foreign commission agents that will not be covered under reverse charge mechanism. I have a question. What will be the place of supply of certifications like CR, carbon credit certificates, which are traded through DMAT accounts, generally regarded as goods? All these certification services in respect of carbon credit certificates, etc., to my mind, these are not covered under any of the specific rules. Hence, general rule will apply, and general rule is location of the recipient. So location of the recipient the certification services which I am providing, place of supply shall be the location of recipient. In case of registered person, it will be the establishment most directly concerned with. Another query is on address on record related to Swiggy, etc. Please note that the example which we took of Zomato and Swiggy, that was in respect of only the delivery charges which they are charging, not in respect of supply of food, only the delivery charges. And what we discussed, that the delivery charges which Zomato and Swiggy is charging, the location of the recipient is the place of supply if address on record is available. And address on record should be residential address and not merely delivery address. So aapko until and unless kisi bhi case mein residential address nahi malum, khali delivery address malum hai, to aap delivery address ke basis pe apni services ka place of supply determine nahi karoge. Hum service ke context mein baat kar rahe hain. Aap residential status ke basis par hi determine karoge, residential address ke basis par hi determine karoge. What event is online? In case of online classes, events, etc., place of supply shall be determined based on general rule, that is location of the recipient. Another issue is temporary establishments for rendering works contract services, etc. See, if I'm rendering a works contract services in another state where I actually open a site office wherein I have human and technical resources, so if I'm executing a works contract, EPC contract in another office, another state, in that state I open a site office, then that will be treated as fixed establishment because it has human and technical resources. And I should bill my customer from that office for the two reasons. First, that is the establishment most directly concerned with my provisioning of services. And second reason is to avail the credit on my subcontractor services. The subcontractor which I will appoint, they will charge CGST, SGST, and I will take credit in that state only if I am registered in that state. Now, A is located outside India, has asked dealer located in Haryana to deliver goods to his customer located in Delhi. So now there is a company, say, located outside India. He is purchasing goods from somebody in India and then selling that goods to somebody in India itself. So he is purchasing from A in India and selling goods to B in India. To my mind, in this situation, since the person who is located outside India, he is purchasing from a company in India A and selling the goods to company in India B, and goods are directly delivered by A to B, in such a situation he is liable to take registration in India. You cannot sit in Dubai, etc., tax free zone, purchase goods in India, sell goods in India, and try to avoid tax by not taking an registration in India. If you are located outside India, you are purchasing in India, and you are selling the very same goods in India, then you are making a supply from India and you are liable to take registration in the state of India. LLP is LP registered in Telangana. Give to manufacturer. I think the issue relates to bill to ship to. So in case of bill to, that relates to place of supply of goods. Let me take a very simple example. I am located in Delhi. My customer gives me a contract. Say there are three parties, A, B, C. A is located in Maharashtra. B is located in Delhi. C is located in Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu customer gives a contract to A, C, the customer C, who's located in Tamil Nadu, gives a contract to A for purchase of goods. A is located in Maharashtra. Since A is only a trader, A is purchasing these goods from me. I am B and I'm located in Delhi. So what A has